This message is brought to you by North Ringwood Uniting Church, a God-focused, grace-filled community helping you grow. We hope you enjoy.
We've been going on with Ephesians now for how long? For 4 weeks, 3 weeks. This is number four. Matt and Carly and Chris all gave. What were some of the key words that stood out? What are the key words they used?
Unity is love.
Love. Love was a big one. And I remember when Matt did his all the love, all the words jumping out of the screen. What are some of the other words? Any ideas? So we got love. What was a key word in what you did, Chris?
I had God's affection or appreciation. Because it had a lot of love words in there, and so...
Thought love had been done.
Yeah, so we have to try and change it. So it was love and appreciation, really. So, yeah, so... but it was also about... I remember from Carly's handiwork and God's, you know, how he could see himself and masterpiece. Yeah, that was it.
And then
James said after me. I don't suppose it.
Any others? Any other key words besides love, affection, appreciation?
Ephesians,
that's a place. The peoples.
In Christ,
yes, that's a good one. What?
Belonging.
Yes, in Christ is another word I'm looking for. It goes with in Christ and love when you join them together. Unity is the one that comes out of Ephesians. Togetherness, community, unity. So love, affection, appreciation, unity are things that we've talked about. Yes? Would we agree? Especially those that have...
Yes.
So let us, with that in our minds, in our background, read the portion that we're going to read today, which is Ephesians 2, 11 to 22. Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcised, by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands, remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away, and peace to you who were near. For through him we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people, and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him you too are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit. It's kind of complex, and often when we read things that Paul writes, it's hard until we get down into them to really grasp what he's on about. The first part, if James, we can go back to the beginning at verse 11. He's talking about the circumcised and the uncircumcised. Well, circumcision is a thing that happens to guys. So we know for a start, he's not talking about women. He's already excluded a whole bunch of people. He's talking about an outward sign that happens to guys. In the Philippines, nearly everybody's circumcised. At the age of 12, you usually go down to the river. They give you what they call bayabas. It's a leaf. You chew it in your thing. And there's a guy down there, he usually has a few stiff gins to settle his nerves before he does it. And the young guys queue up and he has a bit of wood and a big long knife. And he pulls something over the bit of wood and with a big knife he goes whack. And then the stuff you've been chewing on, you stick on there because it's meant to be like an anaesthetic. And then you go up and your mum will take care of you and give you a dress to wear for the next few days until you recover. That's circumcision.
That's how you become a man. How are you?
Chris was really lucky. When he was a little baby in hospital, so wasn't a problem, was it? But if you hadn't been done and you were over the age of 12, it's starting to get into risky territory. And the worst thing you can call someone is saput, which means uncircumcised. So it's a word of denigration that's handed around quite freely if you're doing something that's not quite macho enough. And why I tell you all that is because this is really similar, because the what is described here, the word that's used for the year of the uncircumcised, would have been like a swear word, would have been really saying, you people who are, you're outside this, you're no good, you're not quite right. So in the Philippines, the government has what they call Operation Tuli, Operation Circumcision. They're trying to bring a bit of hygiene into circumcision, so packs of doctors and nurses go out and you might have 1,000 kids queuing up to get circumcised at 12-year-old under sterile and conditions, or semi, with a little bit of anaesthetic.
So. But they're not born in hospitals.
No, they don't do it till about 12, adolescents.
No, I just mean, yeah.
Some people are a bit more, affluent at getting kids done when they're little. So, here, Paul's talking about one group of people who are physically different than another. And you might say, well, how would anyone know if you're uncircumcised or circumcised? Yeah. Well, you were just asking that question just about. How would people know? How would you see? Wouldn't you have your pants on? And how's someone going to see if you're circumcised or uncircumcised? Well, in the Greek world, there was the attitude to being naked in public was quite different than ours. It was quite common, especially in sports. Like you can imagine the AFL being played naked. That's how it would have gone at the Olympic Games and all these other... The Olympic Games was just one big games, but they had lots of regional, and every town or city would have its athletic games. It was an era where they celebrated the masculine form.
And when that's you look why at, all the paintings and statues are
exactly.
Stuff.
You look at it, it's all guys that in the nudist, not a lot of women that barely wearing Greek art. It was kind of the reverse of now. They celebrated the male physical form. And so, it would have been a big deal to actually look physically different if you were competing in the games or something like that. I went to see my brother in Japan, and we went into a public bath where the women were also in the public bath, and you get this little face washer thing which you just sort of put over your private parts when you go into the bath and get out, and that's about it. It was a bit, felt a bit peculiar, but that was quite culturally common for folks in Japan, and the same thing would have been very culturally common in the Greek world of Paul's time. So, a physical difference that makes one group acceptable and the others unacceptable. And Paul uses the word strangers in Greek, xenos, the strangers. Who do we make strangers? Do we make people strangers because they're different from us physically or culturally? Or who are the kinds of people we would make strangers? Any asylum seekers?
Some more than others.
Which ones more than others?
The ones you can't pay.
Ones you can't pay? Mm.
Do any asylum seekers pay?
Or
they
some get on a plane and some don't get on a plane.
Oh, yeah. So ones that come by boat.
Yeah.
But I think we would also discriminate more against Muslim asylum seekers much more than someone like Gershon, who's come from Papua New Guinea, or even the people that come here in the afternoon, the Miso people are from Burma. So even within discriminating against asylum seekers, there's others. There are other people we discriminate against. We turn into strangers.
Mental health, yes, definitely. Chakras, yeah.
And also disabled.
People with disabilities.
So
is there anyone you can think of? You did this in your psychology class recently. People with black eyes and people with blue eyes.
Brown.
Blue. Brown. Are there other people in our world that we...
Those who are smart. People who aren't smart.
So people who are different, intellectually different.
Indigenous, Aboriginal, ugly people.
It's not school, you're only raising your hand.
We do. We have such an obsession with beauty in our culture, don't we? Some people are made into strangers and outsiders. You know this word xenos in the Greek? It means, it's the word used here for the stranger. It changed its meaning. In Paul's writing in Ephesians, it means the stranger. In later Christian writing, it meant a guest. Why would it change its meaning from being a stranger to a guest? That's kind of like very weird. No ideas?
It's very nice.
Well, it's because welcoming the stranger became such a part of Christian culture that what was once called the stranger suddenly later became known as the guest. Or a stranger guest, I guess. There's another word that we use all the time called hospitality. And another word that's used here in the English, hostility. They both come from the same Latin root, host. Host means to welcome someone, yeah? And hostile comes from the opposite of being a host, the unwelcomer. We've got a friend in the Philippines. He used to get a lot of foreign groups come and stay with us and visit us. And Philippines are famous for feeding you. And so my friend would say, we're so good at hospitality. We show these groups that come from Australia and Europe, and we show them hospitality after hospitality until they end in hospital. And I said, well, you're right. It's the same word. It's the same root word for being hospitable as to be hospital. Hospital became the place where you welcomed people in need, people, the outsiders, the ones that were hospices, hostels, all of those things, all from the same. So these two words, hostility and hospitality, abound together. We become hospitable when we welcome those who are strangers. Hospitality overcomes hostility. In the north of the Philippines, where I worked and Christopher and Susanna lived, but much farther north in the remote mountains, I did some work with people who were engaged in tribal war. They're like clan groups, family groups, but of particular different cultural groups. And something small can gradually grow into something big. It might be a dispute over access to water or something like that. And before long, you find these two groups are doing vendetta killings against each other. There was an old man that lived near our house. I said, well, what do you think of clan wars? He said, oh, when I was young, it was okay, but now it's clan massacre. Because when I was young, we had knives and we would go out and it was near impossible to actually catch anyone and kill them, but now they go out with an armor light. And so they can kill 12 in an afternoon. So that was terrible. But when we did these workshops, we were talking to the communities about, well, what overcomes this hostility? What things can make a difference to being in this kind of conflict? And the community shared with us that whenever you have our food, whenever you receive our food, and our food's inside you, we can never kill you because we've already acknowledged you as our guest. So once we acknowledge you as our guest, we can never kill you. So hospitality overcomes hostility. And this is something that Paul's talking about here. What does it mean to come overcome this hostility, discrimination against each other? And in verse 14, he talks about he's talking about Christ now. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility. How can Christ be the one to destroy the dividing wall of hostility? What do you think? Susanna? Christopher? How can Jesus be the one that destroys the hostility between different people? That discrimination, that... Yeah?
By loving everyone the same.
Exactly. And how did... That's a perfect answer.
Why love?
You must be a pastor's daughter, no. How did Christ ultimately show that he loved everyone the same?
Dying for our stuff, everyone's
sins. You know, the image of the cross is often talked about. Sometimes it's a bit corny, but you know, Christ on the cross is outstretched, crucified, suffering, killed by all the hostility that we can imagine. But they point to the image of the outstretched arms, are the welcoming arms, the ones that welcome us as guests, receive us. So it says in Ephesians here that Jesus, in his death on the cross, kills hostility, puts to death hostility. And he does it in his own person, because all the hostility in the world is loaded onto Jesus. But in receiving it, he's the one that welcomes us. Even though we're hostile, he welcomes us as the honoured guests, as the ones he loves. So killing hostility, open arms on the cross. I just reflect on another section. He talks about how we're made citizens. You know, what do you think of as a citizen? What comes to mind when you hear the word citizen? You get certain rights. Yeah. Citizen. Are you a citizen of anywhere, Susanna?
Yes.
Where?
This place and that other place.
Can't be a politician.
Christopher was really annoyed when he was little, when you were in school and you studied the Constitution in the Philippines and you'd done that, you couldn't be president. You can't be present because you have to be natural born, which means no, you can't do anything to change your nationality. So, and I said, well, why are you so upset? Did you want to be president? He said, no, it's just the principle. But when we talk of citizenship, we talk of, it's a political concept, isn't it? We talk of loyalty. We talk of being loyal to something. And Christ is really, Paul's really talking about Jesus here as the object of our new loyalty. If I'm a citizen of the kingdom of God, then obviously I have problems with my dual citizenship. If I'm going to run for office in the kingdom of God, if I'm going to be significant there, that's my loyalty, not the citizenship in the Roman Empire, not the citizenship in my city state or wherever it is. So we're called to overcome hostility between us, because even though we're different, even though we're different physically, visually, even though we're different in terms of wealth and status, in terms of colour, ethnicity, culture, all the rest of it, even though we're different, we are one because we honour the same Lord and Saviour. We're citizens of the same state. And then it goes on to talk about how, as citizens, we're being built. And there's this image of rock by rock. We're being built brick by brick into a new dwelling place, a new temple. And how is that all held together? It's the idea of the capstone. You know how you build an arch, and none of those bricks would stay in place unless you put the key lock one right in the right spot, which holds the rest of the structure in place. Who's the key lock? Jesus is the key lock. Jesus is the one that holds that whole edifice, that whole building that we're a part of in place. Any other reflections? Anyone want to share anything?
I think just on that last one, which was saying that Jesus being the capstone and the key to holding it all together. A lot of the time when I hear people, whether on the train or at uni or whatever, discussing like evolution versus creationism, they're like, yeah, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Like, because that's not what holds my faith together. Like, that's not the important part of my faith.
It's not the focus. It's not. And it's not, ultimately, it's not what holds me and you together, that side of debate. And so I don't have any problems with respecting Christians who, you know, are really obsessed about creationism and all of that. But I think that just losing the plot a little bit because they've lost the focus on what's most important. But really, we're bound together not because we agree on every issue, but because we're bound together as citizens under the kingdom and acknowledge Jesus as the king.
Just one thought about how, you know, before Jesus there was, you know, that one temple where God would reside, but how awesome it is that, like, we are all the temple because we all have God in just, like, inside us wherever we go, and which is pretty awesome. Yeah.
But it also has citizenship as a political concept. Also tells us or gives us a warning that we will often be out of step with the way the dominant culture does things. We're citizens of a different kingdom. We're marching to a different tune, if you like, than the world around us is playing. Sometimes it'll be fine, sometimes the rhythm will come together, but there'll be critical points where the rhythm is very different and we have to say no, or we have to stand up and say, well, in faith, I can't do that. In faith, even though you've made it illegal, I'm going to provide hospitality to an outlawed refugee. Sometimes we're going to have to say,
buy a farm and succeed.
Sorry?
Buy a farm and succeed.
Yeah, buy a farm and succeed.
Become our own nation.
Nation.
I like that person.
Only problem is, I think Jesus had a bigger vision than just one farm.
One farm.
I think it was the whole cosmos, which is even bigger than the world that he had in mind.
For me, when I
should
read these passages, like, you see at the start, the whole difference between circumcision and uncircumcision, you were near and you were far, and it's all about identity, and that when we put ourselves into boxes like this, we become naturally suspicious and even aggressive against people who disagree with us on a particular issue. We see it playing out in media at the moment with the postal vote and the aggression between the two sides. And like James was saying, that by Christ dying on the cross, it says that he brought us peace through his death. It's sort of like those were your identities and they caused you to fight against each other. But there's a new identity that supersedes all those identities, that it supersedes what your race is, what citizenship you have, and that's what Jesus says who you are and what Jesus has made you be, and that's your new identity.
Exactly. And here he talks about a new humanity. We're a new humanity. So it's a whole new culture, it's a whole new identity that is beyond the divisions we usually know in culture, in race, and all that. Down together as a new community. It doesn't know those kinds of distinctions. It's a vision because daily we live out still those prejudices and discriminations. We need to have the courage to live that new humanity that has been offered to us as a possibility. Shall we pray? Loving God, we think of the stranger and we pray that the stranger will become the guest. We think, Lord, of the hostility in the world, and we think, Lord, of your hospitality shown at its deepest in your suffering death upon the cross, that all that the world could throw against you, you took in your own very own self and body. You took it and defeated it. And in your rising from death, you said no to hostility and welcomed all into your friendship and into your love. Loving God, may our lives be shaped by that transformation and that hope. May we live out as the new humanity you have created us to be, citizens of your kingdom. In Jesus' name.